This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book to the Last Man by Zane Grey. Chapter 1. At the end of a dry, uphill ride over barren country, Jean Isbel unpacked to camp at the edge of the cedars, where a little rocky canyon green with willow and cottonwood promised water and grass. His animals were tired, especially the pack mule that had carried a heavy load, and with slow heave of relief they knelt and rolled in the dust. Jean experienced something of relief himself as he threw off his chaps. He had not been used to hot, dusty, glaring days on the barren lands. Stretching his long length beside a tiny rill of clear water that tinkled over the red stones, he drank thirstily. The water was cool, but it had an acrid taste, an alkali bite that he did not like. Not since he had left Oregon had he tasted clear, sweet, cold water, and he missed it just as he longed for the stately, shady forests he had loved. This wild, endless Arizona land bade fair to earn his hatred. By the time he had leisurely completed his tasks, twilight had fallen, and coyotes had begun their barking. Jean listened to the yelps and to the moan of the cool wind in the cedars with a sense of satisfaction that these lonely sounds were familiar. This cedar wood burned into a pretty fire, and the smell of its smoke was newly pleasant. "Reckon maybe I'll learn to like Arizona," he mused, half aloud. "But I've a hankerin' for waterfalls and dark green forests. Must be the Indian in me. Anyway, Dad needs me bad, and I reckon I'm here for keeps." Jean threw some cedar branches on the fire, in the light of which he opened his father's letter, hoping by repeated reading to grasp more of its strange portent. It had been 2 months in reaching him, coming by traveler, by stage and train, and then by boat, and finally by stage again. Written in lead pencil on a leaf torn from an old ledger, it would have been hard to read even if the writing had been more legible. "Dad's written was always bad, but I never saw it so shaky," said Jean, thinking aloud. "Grass Valley, Arizona. Son Jean, come home. Here is your home, and here you're needed. When we left Oregon, we all reckoned you would not be long behind. But it's years now. I am growing old, son, and you was always my steadiest boy. Not that you ever was so damn steady. Only your wildness seemed more for the woods. You take after mother, and your brothers Bill and Guy take after me. That is the red and white of it. You're part Indian, Jean, and that Indian I reckon I am going to need bad. I am rich in cattle and horses. And my range here is the best I ever seen. Lately we have been losing stock. But that is not all nor so bad. Sheepmen have moved into the Tonto and are grazing down on Grass Valley. Cattlemen and sheepmen can never bide in this country. We have bad times ahead. Reckon I have more reasons to worry and need you, but you must wait to hear that by word of mouth. Whatever you're doing, chuck it and rustle for Grass Valley so to make here by spring. I am asking you to take pains to pack in some guns and a lot of shells. And hide them in your outfit. If you meet anyone when you're coming down into the Tonto, listen more than you talk. And last, son, don't let anything keep you in Oregon. Reckon you have a sweetheart, and if so, fetch her along. With love from your dad, Gaston Isbel." Jean pondered over this letter. Judged by memory of his father, who had always been self-sufficient, it had been a surprise and somewhat of a shock. Weeks of travel and reflection had not helped him to grasp the meaning between the lines. "Yes, Dad's grown old," mused Jean, feeling a warmth and a sadness stir in him. "He must be way over 60. But he never looked old. So he's rich now and lost in stock, and going to be sheeped off his range. Dad could stand a lot of rustling, but not much from sheepmen." The softness that stirred in Jean merged into a cold, thoughtful earnestness which had followed every perusal of his father's letter. A dark, full current seemed flowing in his veins, and at times he felt it swell and heat. It troubled him, making him conscious of a deeper, stronger self, opposed to his careless, free, and dreamy nature. No ties had bound him in Oregon, except love for the great still forests and the thundering rivers, and this love came from his softer side. It had cost him a wrench to leave. And all the way by ship down the coast to San Diego, and across the Sierra Madres by stage, and so on to this last overland travel by horseback, he had felt a retreating of the self that was tranquil and happy, and a dominating of this unknown somber self, with its menacing possibilities. Yet despite a nameless regret, and a loyalty to Oregon, when he lay in his blankets, he had to confess a keen interest in his adventurous future, a keen enjoyment of this stark, wild Arizona. It appeared to be a different sky stretching in dark, star-spangled dome over him, closer, vaster, bluer. The strong fragrance of sage and cedar floated over him with the campfire smoke, and all seemed drowsily to subdue his thoughts. At dawn he rolled out of his blankets, and pulling on his boots, began the day with a zest for the work that must bring closer his calling future. White, crackling frost and cold, nipping air were the same keen spurs to action that he had known in the uplands of Oregon, yet they were not wholly the same. He sensed an exhilaration, similar to the effect of a strong, sweet wine. His horse and mule had fared well during the night, having been much refreshed by the grass and water of the little canyon. Jean mounted and rode into the cedars with gladness that at last he had put the endless leagues of barren land behind him. The trail he followed appeared to be seldom traveled. It led, according to the meager information obtainable at the last settlement, directly to what was called the Rim, and from there Grass Valley could be seen down in the basin. The ascent of the ground was so gradual that only in long open stretches could it be seen. But the nature of the vegetation showed Jean how he was climbing. Scant low scraggy cedars gave place to more numerous, darker, greener, bushier ones, and these to high, full-foliaged green-berried trees. Sage and grass in the open flats grew more luxuriously. Then came the pinyons, and presently among them the checker-barked junipers. Jean hailed the first pine tree with a hearty slap on the brown, rugged bark. It was a small dwarf pine struggling to live. The next one was larger, and after that came several, and beyond them pines stood up everywhere above the lower trees. Odor of pine needles mingled with the other dry smells that made the wind pleasant to Jean. In an hour from the first line of pines, he had ridden beyond the cedars and pinyons into a slowly thickening and deepening forest. Underbrush appeared scarce except in ravines, and the ground in open patches held a bleached grass. Jean's eye roved for sight of squirrels, birds, deer, or any moving creature. It appeared to be a dry, uninhabited forest. About midday, Jean halted at a pond of surface water, evidently melted snow, and gave his animals a drink. He saw a few old deer tracks in the mud, and several huge bird tracks new to him, which he concluded must have been made by wild turkeys. The trail divided at this pond. Jean had no idea which branch he ought to take. "Reckon it doesn't matter," he muttered, as he was about to remount. His horse was standing with ears up, looking back along the trail. Then Jean heard a clip-clop of trotting hoofs, and presently espied a horseman. Jean made a pretense of tightening his saddle girths, while he peered over his horse at the approaching rider. All men in this country were going to be of exceeding interest to Jean Isbel. This man at a distance rode and looked like all the Arizonians Jean had seen. He had a superb seat in the saddle, and he was long and lean. He wore a huge black sombrero and a soiled red scarf. His vest was open, and he was without a coat. The rider came trotting up and halted several paces from Jean. "Hello, stranger," he said gruffly. "Howdy yourself," replied Jean. He felt an instinctive importance in the meeting with the man. Never had sharper eyes flashed over Jean and his outfit. He had a dust-colored sunburned face, long, lean, and hard, a huge sandy mustache that hid his mouth, and eyes of piercing light intensity. Not very much hard Western experience had passed by this man, yet he was not old, measured by years. When he dismounted, Jean saw he was tall, even for an Arizonian. "Seen your tracks back a ways," he said, as he slipped the bit to let his horse drink. "We're bound."
"Reckon I'm lost, all right," replied Jean.
"New country for me."
"Sure.
I seen Thet from your tracks and your last camp. Wall, where was you heading for before you got lost?" The query was deliberately cool, with a dry, crisp ring. Jean felt the lack of friendliness or kindliness in it.
"Grass Valley."
"My name's Isbel," he replied shortly. The rider attended to his drinking horse, and presently rebridled him. Then with long swing of leg, he appeared to step into the saddle.
"Sure I knowed you was Jean Isbel," he said.
"Everybody in the Tonto has heard old Gas Isbel sent fare his boy."
"Well then, why did you ask?"
inquired Jean bluntly.
"Reckon I wanted to see what you'd say."
"So?
All right.
But I'm not caring very much for what you say." Their glances locked steadily then, and each measured the other by the intangible conflict of spirit.
"Sure that's natural," replied the rider.
His speech was slow, and the motions of his long brown hands as he took a cigarette from his vest kept time with his words.
"But seeing you're one of the Isbels, I'll HEV my say whether you want it or not.
My name's Coulter and I'm one of the sheepmen Gas Isbel's riled with."
"Coulter.
Glad to meet you," replied Jean.
"And I reckon who riled my father is going to rile me."
"Sure.
If that wasn't so, you'd not be an Isbel," returned Coulter with a grim little laugh.
"It's easy to see you ain't run into any Tonto Basin fellers yet.
Wall, I'm going to tell you that your old man gabbed like a woman down at Greaves's store. Bragged about you and how you could fight and how you could shoot and how you could track a hoss or a man. Bragged how you'd chase every sheep herder back up on the rim.
I'm telling you, because we want you to get our stand right. We're going to run sheep down in Grass Valley."
"Aha.
Well, who's we?"
queried Jean curtly.
"What at?"
"We. I mean the sheepmen rang in this rim from Black Butte to the Apache country."
"Coulter, I'm a stranger in Arizona," said Jean slowly.
"I know little about ranchers or sheepmen.
It's true my father sent for me.
It's true, I dare say, that he bragged, for he was given to bluster and blow.
And he's old now. I can't help it if he bragged about me. But if he has, and if he's justified in his stand against you sheepmen, I'm going to do my best to live up to his brag."
"I get your hunch.
Sure, we understand each other, and that's a powerful help."
"You take my hunch to your old man," replied Coulter as he turned his horse away toward the left.
"That trail leading south is yours.
When you come to the rim, you'll see a bare spot, down in the basin.
Thet LL be Grass Valley."
He rode away out of sight into the woods.
Jean leaned against his horse and pondered.
It seemed difficult to be just to this Coulter, not because of his claims, but because of a subtle hostility that emanated from him.
Coulter had the hard face, the masked intent, the turn of speech that Jean had come to associate with dishonest men. Even if Jean had not been prejudiced, if he had known nothing of his father's trouble with these sheepmen, and if Coulter had met him only to exchange glances and greetings, still Jean would never have had a favorable impression. Coulter grated upon him, roused an antagonism seldom felt.
"Hi-o," sighed the young man, "goodbye to huntin' and fishing. Dad's given me a man's job."
With that he mounted his horse and started the pack mule into the right-hand trail. Walking and trotting, he traveled all afternoon, toward sunset getting into heavy forest of pine. More than one snowbank showed white through the green, sheltered on the north slopes of shady ravines.
and it was upon entering this zone of richer, deeper forest land that Jean sloughed off his gloomy forebodings. These stately pines were not the giant firs of Oregon, but any lover of the woods could be happy under them. Higher still he climbed, until the forest spread before and around him like a level park, with thicketed ravines here and there on each side. And presently that deceitful level led to a higher bench upon which the pines towered, and were matched by beautiful trees he took for spruce. Heavily barked, with regular spreading branches, these conifers rose in symmetrical shape to spear the sky with silver plumes. A graceful gray-green moss waved like veils from the branches. The air was not so dry, and it was colder, with a scent and touch of snow. Jean made camp at the first likely sight, taking the precaution to unroll his bed some little distance from his fire. Under the softly moaning pines, he felt comfortable, having lost the sense of an immeasurable open space falling away from all around him. The gobbling of wild turkeys awakened Jean. Chug-a-lug, 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 chug. There was not a great difference between the gobble of a wild turkey and that of a tame one. Jean got up, and taking his rifle went out into the gray obscurity of dawn to try to locate the turkeys. But it was too dark, and finally when daylight came they appeared to be gone. The mule had strayed, and what with finding it and cooking breakfast and packing, Jean did not make a very early start. On this last lap of his long journey he had slowed down. He was weary of hurrying. The change from weeks in the glaring sun and dust-laden wind to this sweet coot darkly green and brown forest was very welcome. He wanted to linger along the shaded trail. This day he made sure would see him reach the rim. By and by he lost the trail. It had just worn out from lack of use. Every now and then Jean would cross an old trail, and as he penetrated deeper into the forest, every damp or dusty spot showed tracks of turkey, deer, and bear. The amount of bear sign surprised him. Presently his keen nostrils were assailed by a smell of sheep, and soon he rode into a broad sheep trail. From the tracks, Jean calculated that the sheep had passed there the day before. An unreasonable antipathy seemed born in him. To be sure, he had been prepared to dislike sheep, and that was why he was unreasonable. But on the other hand, this band of sheep had left a broad bare swath, weedless, grassless, flowerless in their wake. Where sheep grazed, they destroyed. That was what Jean had against them. An hour later, he rode to the crest of a long park-like slope, where new green grass was sprouting and flowers peeped everywhere. The pines appeared far apart. Gnarled oak trees showed rugged and gray against the green wall of woods. A white strip of snow gleamed like a moving stream away down in the woods. Jean heard the musical tinkle of bells, and the baa-baa of sheep, and the faint sweet bleating of lambs. As he rode toward these sounds, a dog ran out from an oak thicket and barked at him. Next Jean smelled a campfire, and soon he caught sight of a curling blue column of smoke, and then a small peaked tent. Beyond the clump of oaks, Jean encountered a Mexican lad carrying a carbine. The boy had a swarthy, pleasant face, and to Jean's greeting he replied, "Buenos dias." Jean understood little Spanish, and about all he gathered by his simple queries was that the lad was not alone, and that it was lambing time. This latter circumstance grew noisily manifest. The forest seemed shrilly full of incessant baas and plaintive bleats. All about the camp, on the slope, in the glades, and everywhere were sheep. A few were grazing, many were lying down, most of them were ewes suckling white fleecy little lambs that staggered on their feet. Everywhere Jean saw tiny lambs just born. Their pinpointed bleats pierced the heavier baa-baa of their mothers. Jean dismounted and led his horse down toward the camp, where he rather expected to see another and older Mexican, from whom he might get information. The lad walked with him. Down this way the plaintive uproar made by the sheep was not so loud. "Hello there," called Jean cheerfully as he approached the tent. No answer was forthcoming. Dropping his bridle, he went on, rather slowly, looking for someone to appear. Then a voice from one side startled him. "Manan, stranger." A girl stepped out from beside a pine. She carried a rifle. Her face flashed richly brown, but she was not Mexican. This fact, and the sudden conviction that she had been watching him, somewhat disconcerted Jean. "Beg pardon, miss," he floundered. "Didn't expect to see a girl. I'm sort of lost, looking for the rim, and thought I'd find a sheepherder who'd show me. I can't savvy this boy's lingo." While he spoke, it seemed to him an intentness of expression. A strain relaxed from her face. A faint suggestion of hostility likewise disappeared. Jean was not even sure that he had caught it, but there had been something that now was gone. "Sure, I'll be glad to show you," she said. "Thanks, miss. Reckon I can breathe easy now," he replied. "It's a long ride from San Diego. Hot and dusty. I'm pretty tired. And maybe this woods isn't good medicine to H&I's. San Diego. You're from the coast?" "Yes." Jean had doffed his sombrero at sight of her, and he still held it, rather deferentially perhaps. It seemed to attract her attention. "Put on your hat, stranger. Sure, I can't recollect when any man bared his hide to me." She uttered a little laugh, in which surprise and frankness mingled with a tint of bitterness. Jean sat down with his back to a pine, and laying the sombrero by his side, he looked full at her, conscious of a singular eagerness, as if he wanted to verify by close scrutiny a first hasty impression. If there had been an instinct in his meeting with Coulter, there was more in this. The girl half sat, half leaned against a log, with the shiny little carbine across her knees. She had a level, curious gaze upon him, and Jean had never met one just like it. Her eyes were rather a wide oval in shape, clear and steady, with shadows of thought in their amber-brown depths. They seemed to look through Jean, and his gaze dropped first. Then it was he saw her ragged homespun skirt, and a few inches of brown bare ankles, strong and round, and crude worn-out moccasins that failed to hide the shapeliness of her feet. Suddenly she drew back her stockingless ankles and ill-shod little feet. When Jean lifted his gaze again, he found her face half averted and a stain of red in the gold tan of her cheek. That touch of embarrassment somehow removed her from this strong, raw, wild woodland setting. It changed her poise. It detracted from the curious, unabashed, almost bold look that he had encountered in her eyes. "Reckon you're from Texas," said Jean presently. "Sure am," she drawled. She had a lazy southern voice, pleasant to hear. "How'd you all guess that?" "Anybody can tell a Texan. Where I came from, there were a good many pioneers and ranchers from the old Lone Star State. I've worked for several. And, come to think of it, I'd rather hear a Texas girl talk than anybody." "Did you know many Texas girls?" she inquired, turning again to face him. "Reckon I did, quite a good many." "Did you go with them?" "Go with them? Reckon you mean, keep company." "Why, yes, I guess I did, a little," laughed Jean. "Sometimes on a Sunday or a dance, once in a blue moon, and occasionally a ride." "Sure, that accounts," said the girl wistfully. "For what?" asked Jean. "You're being a gentleman," she replied with force. "Oh, I've not forgotten. I had friends when we lived in Texas. 3 years ago. Sure, it seems longer. 3 miserable years in this damned country." Then she bit her lip, evidently to keep back further unwitting utterance to a total stranger. And it was that biting of her lip that drew Jean's attention to her mouth. It held beauty of curve and fullness, and color that could not hide a certain sadness and bitterness. Then the whole flashing brown face changed for Jean. He saw that it was young, full of passion and restraint, possessing a power which grew on him. This, with her shame and pathos and the fact that she craved respect, gave a leap to Jean's interest. "Well, I reckon you flatter me," he said, hoping to put her at her ease again. I'm only a rough hunter and fisherman, woodchopper and horse tracker. Never had all the school I needed, nor near enough company of nice girls like you. Am I nice? She asked quickly. You sure are, he replied, smiling. In these rags, she demanded, with a sudden flash of passion that thrilled him. Look at the holes. She showed rips and worn-out places in the sleeves of her buckskin blouse, through which gleamed a round brown arm. I sew when I have anything to sew with. Look at my skirt, a dirty rag. And I have only one other to my name. Look. Again a color tinged her cheeks, most becoming and giving the lie to her action. But shame could not check her violence now. A dammed-up resentment seemed to have broken out in flood. She lifted the ragged skirt almost to her knees. No stockings. No shoes. How can a girl be nice when she has no clean, decent woman's clothes to wear? How can a girl, began Jean. See here, miss, I'm begging your pardon for sort of stirring you to forget yourself a little. Reckon I understand. You don't meet many strangers and I sort of hit you wrong, making you feel too much and talk too much. Who and what you are is none of my business. But we met. And I reckon something has happened, perhaps more to me than to you. Now let me put you straight about clothes and women. Reckon, I know most women love nice things to wear and think because clothes make them look pretty that they're nicer or better. But they're wrong. You're wrong. Maybe it'd be too much for a girl like you to be happy without clothes. But you can be. You act just as nice and fine and for all you know a good deal more appealing to some men. Stranger, you sure must excuse my temper and the show I made of myself, replied the girl with composure. That, to say the least, was not nice. And I don't want anyone thinking better of me than I deserve. My mother died in Texas, and I've lived out here in this wild country, a girl alone among rough men. Meeting you today makes me see what a hard lot they are, and what it's done to me. Jean smothered his curiosity, and tried to put out of his mind a growing sense that he pitied her, liked her. Are you a sheep herder? He asked. Sure I am now and then. My father lives back here in a canyon. He's a sheep man. Lately there's been herders shot at. Just now we're short and I have to fill in. But I like shepherdin' and I love the woods and the rim rock and all the tonto. If they were all, I'd sure be happy. Herders shot at, exclaimed Jean thoughtfully. By whom? And what for? Trouble brewin' between the cattlemen down in the basin and the sheepmen up on the rim. Dad says there'll sure be hell to pay. I tell him I hope the cattlemen chase him back to Texas. Then, are you on the rancher's side? Queried Jean, trying to pretend casual interest. No. I'll always be on my father's side, she replied with spirit. But I'm bound to admit, I think the cattlemen have the fair side of the argument. How so? Because there's grass everywhere. I see no sense in a sheepman going out of his way to surround a cattleman and sheep off his range. That started the row. Lord knows how it'll end. For most all of them heya are from Texas. So I was told, replied Jean. And I heard most all these Texans got run out of Texas. Any truth in that? Sure I reckon there is, she replied, seriously. But stranger, it might not be healthy for you to say that anywhere. My dad, for one, was not run out of Texas. Sure I never can see why he came here. He's accumulated stock, but he's not rich nor so well off as he was back home. Are you going to stay here always? Queried Jean, suddenly. If I do so, it'll be in my grave, she answered darkly. But what's the use of thinking? People stay places until they drift away. You can never tell. Well, stranger, this talk is keeping you. She seemed moody now, and a note of detachment crept into her voice. Jean rose at once and went for his horse. If this girl did not desire to talk further, he certainly had no wish to annoy her. His mule had strayed off among the bleating sheep.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.